What would you be doing right now today to prepare for or to incorporate AI?
Well, David, it's an excellent question. And as I think about it, I would think about all the lessons I've learned in the past, either running IBM or if I was currently a CEO, what I've learned over the past 10 or 15 years. And that is that we faced these challenges before. There's always been these disruptive technologies to come along. They represent from phenomenal promise, but also they can be disruptive. There are a couple of different paths. I mean, I'll make some suggestions, but you could dismiss it. You can wait and see, but then, you know, we learned in the last time that you can be left behind if you do that and other leaders emerge in your peer group. Another way to do it is let it just go. Like, that would be the early days of the internet. Just let it run. And then the problem is then you have to clean it all up, you know, and that takes time. You lose some momentum, also costs you some money and those sorts of things. But I would start with create a management system that takes advantage of these technologies in your strategy. Implement that company-wide. The benefit of starting there is you won't have the problems of the past with digitization and the internet. And plus, you can scale and integrate and learn a lot quicker once you get your footing and you know where you want to go to take your business. The other thing is that I'll add is these technologies are going to mature, and they will. I mean, there's a lot of innovation yet to come. As exciting as this is, there's a lot more to happen here, and it has to happen. There are gaps that need to be filled. Having said that, it becomes ubiquitous, which means it touches everybody in your workforce. So you have to think about the jobs, the nature of work, and how it changes, how you develop skills. And it's not go out and hire 3 data scientists. You're going to have to train and educate your people across the entire enterprise. And the last one I would think about is culture. Culture is so, so important. You need to adopt ethical principles for AI. We see the issues today for companies that haven't done that. You need to be trusted in this space if you're an enterprise. But they're the things that a management system, think about learning of your employee base and the impact to them and your culture.
One of the issues I suspect is productivity. I mean, AI, generative AI, has the potential at least to really increase the productivity of a company, something that we're always looking for. How do you make sure that you take advantage of that as a CEO without letting it go too far?
Well, that's exactly the point. You know, it's fundamentally what you need to do is, I would say, you need to think about the technology as a complement to what's going on today. So therefore, your knowledge worker can become an expert, not just an average knowledge worker, or a teacher can become an expert teacher, not just a participant in teaching grammar or language, whatever it happens to be. So if you think about it that way, is that how do you complement the technology with the worker, the knowledge worker in your organization? I think if you do that, you won't have all the chaos that occurred historically. I mean, chaos was okay. We learned. I mean, so there's nothing wrong with learning, but let's take the learnings of the past and try to avoid those as we get into the future here.
Sam, what is the role, if any, of the government in all this? There's a lot of talk about regulation. We already saw China come out with a draft set of regulations, basically saying, yes, whatever you do with this generative AI, it's got to be consistent with our values, which is all the censorship that comes with that. So when it comes to U.S. government, Europe, India, what is the constructive role of government in really directing AI in constructive ways?
Well, I think government does have a role, and we see what happens when government's late to get ahead of these kinds of issues. You see that today with the social media companies and the issues around data and data privacy. So there's clearly a role, but the challenge is, as we know and as we've learned, these regulations and standards have to be global. I mean, standards will emerge over time that are global. That takes a long time. So in the interim, what does a regulator do? And that's, you've laid out the problem, David. That's where it gets complicated because there's different systems. There's I'll call it the Chinese control system. There's the open system of the United States and, let's say, some of the West, but then Europe somewhere in between. So how do you get global regulation that's consistent? And to do this regionally just won't work. It won't work because fundamentally these platforms are global by definition. They're open source software by definition. So I know regions think they can take control, but the technology moves so fast, they will really struggle in doing so, unless you completely shut the place down and you wall it off. And that has economic implications. So to me, the question is, in the interim, what do you do? And I think there's a role here for business leaders and companies. I think business leaders and companies can show the way. They could establish the guardrails, the principles, ethical transparency, and implement this themselves
And finally, Sam, this week we had some of the biggest tech companies reporting earnings, and almost all the discussion was really about AI and generative AI and its potential. And there are people in the street, you know this right now, who are saying maybe this will give a new impetus to the tech sector generally. It had been such a growth sector for so long, then it was waning just a little bit in the growth. Now they say, but this is a whole new wave. Do you think they're right?
Well, it's definitely going to be a huge growth in innovation opportunities. There's no doubt about it. The question, though, David, is who emerges as the winner here? So I'll take you back a little bit in history. If I go back, like 50 years of the tech industry, it's interesting to see these patterns of who emerges as the winner. Take client server to cloud. Surely Microsoft was the winner with Intel, the technology provider in client server. Who's been the winner? There's no doubt Amazon's the winner. Let's go to the current world, I'll call it hyperscalers and large data model companies, social media. We know who the winners have been. Obviously, it's the Facebooks, it's the Googles, it's the Apples of the world have done very, very well in this environment. Who's going to emerge in the future? That's the question. I mean, because some of these things can be disruptive to the business models, especially to things like advertising and search, it could potentially be disruptive. At the same time, a lot of these issues that still exist that need to be resolved as far as the governance of the data, the transparency of the data, the issues around the fact that there's bias and it needs to be addressed, all that has to happen. The scale required to run these models, Dave, a use case for a large language model, literally to get one use case is $100 million of infrastructure. I mean, that's not going to happen. It's almost like semiconductors. And so this will all have to be addressed. And there's tremendous opportunities. So I think really the question for our colleagues, especially from an investor perspective, is, who's going to win and where do you place your bets?